to give a talk before leaving the institute. She's now moving to the Entoto Observatory, as she mentioned in her presentation. She has, what can I say about Miliana? Well, I can say too many things, so I will try to summarize. Miliana has spent here in the institute 5 years working with us. She came when we just started, were in the middle of the Alhambra survey, and she was involved in the Alhambra survey. She was very encouraged with this survey, and finally she produced a very nice work. And also she has been engaged in other projects that we have in our group. And the most recent project that she has been working on and she wanted to share with us is the work about the most luminous liners in the local universe. So she's a very, very broad mind astronomer. She has been working a lot with surveys and now with the local universe. Her career started in Canary Islands. She did there her PhD with Jordi Zepa and Ana Pérez. The next 5 years she came to the institute. You will listen first and realize how well she's doing astronomy. And I hope I will take the opportunity to congratulate her for her stay here and the nice work she has produced. And I wish the best for the next adventure, that is a great adventure from my point of view, because she's moving to Africa, to these several countries, with the main idea to help these people to improve knowledge in astronomy and science in general. So I really wish her our best from the institute. Thank you, Miriam.
Thank you, Pepa. Okay. Thank you all for coming and for taking a short break from your work. So I will give the presentation in English. That's fine, you know, with all of you, no? Okay, so as Pepa said, it's been a few years now that since I'm here at the Institute, but this is the first seminar that I'm giving. I gave a few others, but in the section of the outreach. So the main talk is related with the last work that we did where we studied the star formation and AGN activity in the most luminous liners in the local universe. But I was thinking just to, since it's, as I said, the first seminar, since I'm leaving soon, just to take the opportunity to go fast through some of the other activities that I took over the past the few last years. So I'm working with the group of, all this time I was in the group of the nuclear activity in galaxies. Here you can see the picture of those of us involved here in the institute, or almost all, or is already outside. And then there is a long list of collaborators from other institutions. And my activities were mainly focused in two fields. The first one is based on the morphological classification of galaxies in the case when we are mainly dealing with the low resolution data or high redshift data, and when the morphological classification becomes quite challenging. And then also with the properties on the other side, I was working with the properties of active galaxies using different bands, X-rays, infrared, and then optical as well. So, as I said, I will go fast through some of the main works that we did in the last few years. So one of them was that for the first time we studied in details how the spatial resolution and then the deepness of the data are affecting the morphological classification of galaxies. So it's been known for a long time that both parameters are very important for the morphological classification, but it was not studied really depending on the surveys in many details. So we did when applying the non-parametric method. So basically, when you have images similar to this, and then when you have for all these small dots, you have to say what are their morphological properties, and you can't do either the visual classification or the decomposition of the galaxy, and then you are measuring different parameters related either with the concentration of the light or the shape or the clumpiness of your galaxy, and then people are representing the diagrams like this, combining two or the three parameters, and then they can separate between different morphological types, like in this case concentration and symmetry, where we have the early types and then the later morphological types. So we know that, as I said, that these diagrams do change from, and these limits change from one survey to another. So in this work, what we did was we selected three different surveys, Cosmos, Subaru, and then Alhambra, with different properties in terms of the resolution and then the deepness. All three are deep surveys, and then we use the sample of 3,000 local galaxies that we know their visual morphology. We simulated these galaxies. We moved to the properties of each of these three surveys, so moving them from their redshift and magnitude distributions to the distributions corresponding to high redshift data. So basically here you can see that studying in different magnitudes, all three surveys, so in the case of Alhambra, Subaru, and then Cosmos, we obtained for all original images how the, after simulation, how the galaxies will look like. So basically, if we take the example in Alhambra, for this spiral galaxy, when moving from 0.04 to 0.5 in redshift, you will basically detect this spiral galaxy as elliptical galaxy, as early type galaxy. So then using this, we were able for the first time to evaluate all the diagrams in the three different surveys to put the conditions depending on the, as I said, deepness, the spatial resolution, how reliable are the morphological diagrams that have been used in previous works, and then to put the quantification of the bias once we determine early or late type, what is the contamination that we can expect. Another, Pepa mentioned our participation in the Alhambra survey, really active participation, and one of the works again that we did was related with the morphological classification of all galaxies in the survey using the method that I mentioned previously. So we classified all galaxies below 23 in our band, yes.
Okay. Did you use, in this you use one band, or you use
Yes. So in this case, so we used the rest frame band. Okay. So basically, depending on the magnitude and the redshift that the local galaxy was moved, so we used the corresponding rest frame in this for the local ones. So basically, it was between U or and IZ in Sloan.
One per galaxy.
Sorry.
One per galaxy.
Exactly. Yes. Okay, and yes, so as I said, we classified all galaxies in Alhambra below fainter than 23 in our band, and so more than 22,000 sources, we obtained the reliable morphology, and here you can see the color magnitude, and then the color, this is the color stellar mass, and then the color magnitude diagrams for the late type galaxies in blue, and then for the red type galaxies in red. Another work that we did was to deal with the morphological and color properties of X-ray detected AGN, but at higher redshifts, up to redshift 2, in Subaru field and then the Broad field. Here is the luminosity, X-ray luminosity distribution of both samples, and then we studied the color magnitude, color stellar mass diagrams in function of the morphology, the X-ray obscuration and the X-ray to optical flux ratio. And we found that the AGN host galaxies, even at higher redshifts, are again mainly bulge-dominated and early types, like in the case of the local galaxies, local active galaxies, but the population of late types was higher. Yes.
Did you normalize that for the overall cosmological evolution? The late types? I mean,
what do
I
you
think
mean?
At redshift set 2, you get more late types anyway than at redshift 0, right? Or not?
Yes. At redshift 2, we didn't. As you can see here, most of them are going to redshift. Let me. Yes, here.
At higher redshifts, you have more late types, right?
At high redshift, you will have more late types.
So do you get disproportionately more late types for the AGNs, or is that...
I mean, the sample is not complete, so it is very difficult to say, because we first... I mean, these are the X-ray detected AGN, but then we went to the optical data, we searched for the counterpart, so basically... And then we had to measure the photometric redshifts, where again the number of sources with reliable photometric redshifts decreased. So the sample is not complete. So we just got that the higher population of late types than in comparison with the early types than when compared with the local ones. But as I said, it's not complete in order to give the entire picture. Okay, and then in the last few years, I also took an active participation in the GLACE survey. This is one of the quite new surveys. It comes from Galaxy Cluster Evolution Survey, where we used the Osiris instrument and the two Nebel filters at the GTC. And then several clusters have been selected, and different lines were observed. So in particular, I was participating mainly in the project, again, related with the morphological classification and study of the galaxies in this galaxy cluster, which is a young galaxy cluster. And it was quite challenging because, again, only the ground-based data are available. And this was the first time that it's been tried to deal with the morphology. So here you can see the cluster, the image with the virial radius, and then the members are in green, the morphologically classified with reliable morphology are in red. So we just obtained about 30% of the classification for 30% of members. However, the results were quite interesting. Here you can see the color magnitude diagram, and all classified sources are in the bigger symbols. And we got that about between 60-70% of those galaxies classified as early type actually have blue colors. So in the paper, and as I said, it's a young, it's a very interesting cluster to be studied because it's a young one. It's a cluster that is just forming right now. So in the paper, then we went through different analyses in order to confirm that our classification is reliable, and then we are discussing different possibilities for what could be the origin of these blue early type galaxies in this kind of cluster. Okay, now I will switch to the main part. So as I said, one of the last works that we did, we studied the star formation and AGN activity in the most luminous liners in the local universe. So first, the introduction for those of you who are not very similar with liners. Liner comes from the acronym of low ionization nuclear emission line regions. And one of the first who did the spectral classification and the description of these sources was Heckman in 1980s. Here you can see three different spectra. The first one is the typical spectra of Seyfert galaxy, and then the liner galaxy. So Heckman described these sources as sources whose optical spectra is characterized with strong low ionization emission lines like oxygen 1 or nitrogen 2. He observed that usually there are, we are talking about early type galaxies and the galaxies with lower luminosities than in the case of Seyfert. So he was the first one who proposed the connection between the liners and then the AGN. So what are the AGN? The AGN comes from active galactic nuclei. Again, in the 80s, was given the first more detailed description of AGN being high luminosity areas in the central parts of the galaxies, with very often variable and very compact, very often related with the radio jets. Here you can see the standard model of the AGNs. I think all of you are already familiar with it, where we have the supermassive black hole in the center, the accretion disk, the obscuring torus, sometimes the radio jet, and then the part of the material with higher and lower temperatures from where we believe from where the emission, the narrow and broad emission lines that we're observing in the spectra are coming from. And then there are different unification models of AGN, because we find a huge diversity of active galaxies. I didn't say that galaxies that we have that have AGN in the center we call active galaxies. And one of the unification models, so there is one is related with radio loud, radio cloud, another one with type 1, type 2, depending if we see the broad lines in the spectral or not. Then another, the most popular one, is related with the orientation angle, where depending on the orientation, we believe to see different types of AGN. And then there is another unification where we also separate the AGN into high luminosity and low luminosity AGN. So basically, liners would be the active galaxies that are related with the low luminosity AGNs. And they are studied, quite important, first because they form most of the AGN population. So basically about two-thirds, at least in the local universe, of all active galaxies are liners. And then they could be related with also the transition between active and non-active galaxies. However, it is very difficult to their detection is difficult due to the extinction, and then as I said, since they are low luminosity AGN, the extinction, and then also the contamination that you have from the star formation from the host galaxies. So most of them, that's why most of them were actually studied mainly in the local universe. This is one of the main diagrams that we are using to classify liners. So the standard BPT diagrams, where we use the emission line ratios between the high ionization and the lower ionization emission lines. And then in this area would be is the area where we find liners where we usually find liners. The possibilities, excitation mechanisms for these sources, several possibilities have been proposed. So the first one is the non-stellar photoionization coming from the being related with the AGN. Then the shocks were also proposed as excitation mechanism, and then the stellar photoionization as well. In the last few years, the stellar photoionization was studied quite a lot, and it was proposed that the post-AGB stars can give the luminosities for many of those liners that in the previous BPT diagrams were entering in the liner areas. And then in 2011, the one diagram was introduced where putting in addition the equivalent width of the H alpha, it is possible to separate between those liners that are mainly related with post-AGB activity and then with the AGN activity. Okay, so the star formation in liners was not studied much in the previous works, and as I said, it was only studied in the local universe. It's been seen that the star formation is not significant in these kind of sources. As I already mentioned, As Heckman saw in the 80s, it was confirmed with larger samples that usually in the local universe these sources are in early type galaxies. With having older stellar populations and then quite low extinctions. Here is, this is one of the last results taking the entire sample of the Sloan survey. And the authors separated using the BPT diagrams all the galaxies into star forming, then the composite, then Seyfert, and then the liner, and then liners. And you can see here, this is the main sequence of the star formation from Elbus from 2007. And you can see here that the majority of the liners lie below this main sequence, where also the early type galaxies are located. Okay, so when we go to the high redshift, the only work that has been done up to now regarding liners comes from a few years ago. So the group of Thomasin worked with data from Cosmos and then selected a sample at 0.3 in redshift. And they used the far infrared data and selected a sample of 32 liners. And then they studied their star forming properties and AGN properties as well. And this is one of their main results, where they compared the AGN luminosity with the infrared luminosity in far infrared, assuming that the far infrared luminosity is equal to the star formation luminosity. And then, so this is their sample of around 30 galaxies in red, and then they compared their distribution with the nearby liners from Hope, which is the standard sample that has been used in most of the studies up to now. And they saw that in both properties, in AGN luminosity and then star forming luminosity, there is an important difference between the two samples, as you can see here. About two order of magnitudes are higher, the star formation rates that they are finding at higher redshifts. So regarding to this, they proposed different things, different possibilities in order to explain these results. So first, there is an issue of the aperture. So in the case of Ho, we are observing here very, very nuclear areas. However, when you go to redshift 0.3, in Cosmos, we are getting basically the information from the entire galaxy. Then the second could be maybe related with the selection effect in the far infrared, because these galaxies are just far infrared selected. So basically, they are the most luminous liners that we can observe at 0.3 that have been observed with Herschel. Then they also assume that maybe these kind of sources do exist in the local universe, but they have not been studied systematically, maybe because we need much larger areas in order to detect them. And finally, they also propose that there could be the evolutionary, there could be the evolution. The evolutionary effect between the zero redshift 0 and 0.3 for this kind of liners. Okay, so so basically, when we started with the project, our motivation was related with two main things. So first, as I mentioned, since the star formation in liners was not studied much, so it was. It was important, we see it important to study it in more details, and then definitely we were motivated also with the result that I just explained from Thomasin, and we wanted to see if these kind of sources, if such luminous liners can be detected in the local universe, and if they are detected, if they are there, what are their properties. So the proposal was to first search for these kind of sources using the Sloan sample, then to send to get the far infrared data with Herschel, and then to obtain also the long slit spectroscopy of the central regions of these liners, and then use different methods to study the star formation rates. So the sample selection We started with DR4 Sloan sample, and then using the measurements from the Max Planck group and the BPT diagrams, the liners were selected. And also the redshift range was included to make sure that we are complete. We know that the Sloan is complete more or less up to 0.1. So all these blue dots are the liners that we selected with these criteria, and also making sure that liners are related with the AGN activity. And then since we needed to send, since the idea was to send the proposal for Herschel, we had to make sure that these sources will be observed with Herschel so that they are luminous enough. So then the first criteria was to measure the AGN luminosity and then to take the most luminous sources in terms of the AGN luminosity. So the first around 150 luminous liners were selected. And for them, the AGN luminosities are about 44.3. And then another condition was, as I said, the star formation that with Herschel we can detect. So we also took the condition of the star formation luminosities and selected then the 50 brightest sources and with these luminosities, taking 50 sources as a sample system that. Can give us the significant can be significantly reliable. So basically, all galaxies that we selected are marked here with blue. So Hagai sent the proposal for Herschel, the asking the time for all 50 sources, but he got. Only the priority two times, so only six sources have been observed, and the data have been reused using the standard tools. Then we, using the IRAS data, we were able to get the far infrared for another 13 sources. So in total, we obtained for about 30% of our sample the far infrared data, and then the optical spectroscopy. We carried out using the Color Alto, the 3.5 meter telescope at the Color Alto Observatory, and then the NOT Observatory as well. At Color Alto, we got 24 nights inside the guaranteed time, and were able to observe the 42 liners in total, in both red and blue. With the average, seeing was around one, and then with NOT data, we got 4 nights. We observed 10 sources again in both parts of the spectra, blue and red, and the average seeing there was better, around 0.8. So in total, we have the optical spectroscopy for 42. Most luminous liners, and as I said, for 16 sources in far infrared. This is so we go through the for all nights. We went through the data reduction using the standard steps. Then we, in order to make sure that the calibration, that the final calibrated spectra are fine, we compared with Sloan, but scaling to the area, our data to the area of Sloan, because as I said. We are getting with our spectra only the central parts of liners. And here you can see the comparison for some examples. And in general, we got the differences below 20% between the two. So the for the analysis, first we went through the measurements of the 4,000 break and then the H delta index using just the calibrated spectra. So in the works, in the previous works, mainly of Kaufman, it's been seen that both of these parameters are related with the star formation rates, with the ages, and then the stellar the star formation histories as well. So our main reason to measure these parameters was actually to get these parameters in order to measure after the star formation rates. And then H delta was just measured in order to make sure that measurements of these parameters are consistent. So we compare these two parameters with the models from Kaufman in order to make sure that that our measurements are fine. And to measure both of them, we just use the standard procedure from these two papers, and then measuring the H delta, so taking these two, measuring the flux, the average flux in these two areas, and then the integrated flux in this area, and then between 3,800-900 and 4,000-4,100, the ratio in order to get the star formation, the DN4000. And to get the star formation rates from the DN4000, as I said, it's been seen in previous works, so basically in models that have been done by Bridgman, that this parameter is related with the specific star formation rate. So we basically use this later to measure the star formation rates. So one of the things that we needed in order to measure the properties of the emission lines in our spectra was to obtain the emission line spectra. Then we also wanted to see what is the combination of the stellar populations that we have in our liners. So in order to do the spectral energy distribution fitting, we used the starlight. So first we extracted the nuclear spectra, just the central regions of our galaxies, and then after doing the galactic extinction correction, then K correction and moving spectra to the rest frame, we run starlight for all sources using the Broussolle and Charlotte templates, the solar metallicity, and then 25 stellar ages. And we obtained the very good fits with the standard deviation parameter typical for starlight models below 6, which is the standard value for more than 60 sources, and then the good fits for the others. So at the end, as an output that we got from starlight, we were able to get the emission spectra to see what is the combination of the stellar population that we have, to get the information about the extinction. And then we measured the stellar masses, the average ages, and then the star formation rates as well. So here is the example. I'm sure you're, since Rosa and Enrique are using it a lot, so I'm sure you are familiar already how starlight is working. So here in blue, these are just few examples. In blue are our calibrated spectra, and then in red are the best fits obtained with starlight. So basically, at the end, we obtained what is the best combination. Here you can see in terms of the light and the mass, what is the best combination for each galaxy of the stellar populations that we gave as the entrance. And then once we obtained the best fit model in red, we subtracted that best fit model and then obtained the emission line spectra that you can see here in black. And then we were able to use this emission line spectra for our measurements. So we measured the properties, the fluxes, equivalent widths of all strong emission lines. Then we went through the extinction correction of all emission lines using H alpha H beta ratio. And then finally through the emission line ratios and standard diagrams like BPT and 1, we did the revision of our classification of liners using now the nuclear spectra and not the Sloan spectra as it was done previously, and comparing it with the new data from the Max plot, where the calibration in Sloan also improved. So we found that two liners could be possibly the safer two galaxies, so we discarded them from the analysis, so we stayed at the end with 40 sources for our analysis. 40 sources that have been, as I said, detected in the in all DR4 sample. So the next step was to measure the AGN luminosity. We use the extinction correction luminosities of oxygen free and then H beta to measure these luminosities. We also measure the AGN luminosities through the oxygen one line, but since oxygen one was not available for many of our sources at the end, in order to have it done in a consistent way, we just use the AGN luminosities measured in this way. And then we measured the star formation rates using different methods, but before that we wanted to make sure if we can use the H alpha and oxygen 2 emission lines that usually are used for measuring the star formation rates, if we can use these two lines in our case. So to do that, we have to quantify how strong is the AGN contribution to these two lines in order to be able to say if the star formation rates based on them are reliable or not. So to do that, we did it for H alpha line. This is the standard expression using the Krupa initial mass function. First we measured the H alpha luminosity just through our measurements of the H alpha flux. And then we took the star formation rates that we measured for the young stellar population obtained with the starlight, so using only the absorption spectra now, and we measured what would be the luminosity of H alpha when we are assuming these star formation rates. And then from comparing the two luminosities, we were able to say how strong is the contribution of the AGN for our sources. And we've seen that it is quite strong, that for most of the sources the contribution is above 60%. So we decided to not use neither H alpha or oxygen 2 as star formation rate estimators in our work. So at the end, for measuring the star formation rates, we used three different methods. The first one from the starlight best fits. So we applied the standard formula from Sid Fernandez. Then from our measurements of the N4000 using the models from Bridgman, we again measured the star formation rates. And finally, the third method was using the far infrared data. So in the case of the far infrared, we assumed that the total luminosity in far infrared is equal to star formation luminosity. So in the case of Herschel data, the total far infrared luminosity was measured through spectral energy distribution fitting using the templates of ELBAS. And then in the case of IRAS, we measured the total far infrared flux using only the bands at 60 and 100 microns, and then using the formula of Sanders. So then we studied the general properties of the most luminous liners. So in the terms of the mass, here you can see the distribution for the nuclear masses that we measured, that we got from starlight best fits. The average value, the median value is around 1.5 10 to 10. And then here is the comparison of the total mass taken from the Sloan data of our most luminous liners, then the sample of the luminous liners, the initial 150 sources, luminous in terms of the AGN luminosity. And then we compared these two distributions with the distribution of the mass, the stellar mass, of the 0.3 liners studied by Thomasy. We've seen that the most luminous liners that we are studying in terms of the star formation are not really the most, the most massy ones. And then the distributions in comparison with the high redshift liners, the peak of both distributions overlap. Then in terms of the extinction, again, we measured the extinction. In two ways. So from the emission lines, and then also we got the extinction from the starlight. But the one that we are representing here is using the emission line, the emission lines H alpha and H base and H alpha H beta. This is the distribution for the nuclear spectra, and then this is again the distribution for the entire galaxy when we take the data from Sloan and we measure the AV parameter in the same way as here. So we can see in both. Here again, in the blue is our sample of the most luminous liners. This one is the entire sample of the luminous liners, and in this case, we compared with the extinctions of the nearby liners studied by Ho. So in general, we've seen that we have the wide range of extinctions, but when comparing with the nearby galaxies, nearby liners from the whole sample, our extinctions are higher. So the median is around 1.65, and then the median extinction for the nearby liners is around 1. To get information about morphology, we went to the Sloan images, and then we classified, the three of us classified it separately, and we found around 40, we found that basically all morphologies are present, about 40% are early types, 20% spirals, and then we found about 25% of peculiar galaxies. So this is again quite different in comparison with the standard sample of nearby liners, where they are just normal galaxies and without many connections with interactions or mergers. And mainly, as I said, hosted by early types. So we compared the morphological properties with the properties again of the sample at of most luminous liners at redshift 0.3. But previously we scaled the images. So in this case we have Hubble images. So we scaled the Hubble images to map to our conditions, to map the same resolution as we are having in the case of Sloan, and then we did the morphological classification exactly in the same way as for our sample. So in general, we found that that at redshift 0.3, the number of late-type galaxies are higher than in the case of our sample at between 0.04 and 0.1. So in this case here, we are representing in blue our most luminous liners, so the sample of most luminous liners, and then the most luminous liners at 0.3 from Thomasine Warp. And then in this case, we have the entire sample of luminous liners in terms of AGM luminosity, and then the entire sample of liners detected at 0.3 in red. Okay, so and then in terms of the star formation rates and stellar populations, so we found that for the nuclear areas, similar, we found a similar result as in previous studies, that we have mainly early, old, and intermediate stellar populations. And then in terms of the star formation rates for the nuclear spectra, we got the average star formation rates around 3 solar masses per year. But then for the far infrared data, it was higher. It was around 13 solar masses per year, but there we are mapping the entire galaxy. So in order to compare the optical measurements with the far infrared, we scaled our nuclear measurements to the entire galaxy, assuming that the specific star formation rate is constant. And in that case, we got that the average quite similar values, that the average star formation rates are around 10. In these two pictures, we compare the star formation rates measured with different methods. So in this case, with DN4000 and then the starlight measurements, and you can see that the measurements are quite consistent. when we go to the comparison between the optical and then far infrared data, the dispersion is stronger. However, as I said, the average value is quite similar, but you can see the dispersion is stronger, but we don't find any systematic trend in this case. So these kind of differences between the optical and far infrared measurements of star formation rates have been already reported in many previous works. And actually, most of the works, the difference was even stronger than in our case. In some cases, even 30 times are higher the star formation rates in far infrared than in optical. So some of the possibilities of this difference could be first the aperture differences that very often are present between optical and far infrared data. In our case, also the assumption that the specific star formation rate is constant, that we are assuming to map the entire galaxy, also could introduce the uncertainties. And then also there is the issue of the torus geometry, and then how this torus geometry is affecting the optical and far infrared information, because it doesn't have to affect in the same way. Then we went, after all measurements, we went to the plot to reproduce the plot from the Thomasin paper, representing now the AGN luminosity versus the star formation luminosity. So all colored dots are our data measured with star formation rates measured either with Herschel in green, with IRAS in blue, or with DN 4000. And then in crosses you can see the Thomasin at 0.3 liners, most luminous liners. So basically we see that our sample completely enters in the same area as the sample at redshift 0.3. And then again, as I mentioned at the beginning, the whole sample of nearby galaxy would be in this area. We also see here that this is the one-to-one relation, so we see that all these sources lie along this one-to-one relation, suggesting that there is a coevolution between these two parameters for these kind of sources. And this is the relation from Nature 2009, the typical line related with AGN-dominated sources. So we can see that most of our sources lie above this AGN-dominated line. So basically, with this, we first confirm the existence of the same sources as have been detected at 0.3. in terms of AGN luminosity, star-forming luminosity, and then stellar masses as well. And with this, we can basically eliminate the explanation that, one of the explanations that authors gave, that there might be the evolutionary effect between redshift 0 and redshift 0.3. And then we also observed what is the location of our sources on the main sequence of the star formation. So we represented the stellar mass in relation with the star formation rate. This is the typical, this is the main sequence of star formation, star forming galaxy taken from Whitaker work. And then this would be the typical width that in different works show the 1 sigma width of the main sequence. So we took that, so when we are talking about the main sequence, we are considering all the galaxies that are entering in this area. So we can see that basically all our sources are located inside of the main sequence. And again, in the same area where the Thomasin sources are lying. And then in comparison with the local samples, so this is the, here we represent the area typical of the local, of the low redshift liners from Leslie's work that I showed at the beginning, where more than 60% of all standard local liners lie. So we can see that all our sources lie about that. So we are talking about liners with very particular properties. In order to see how the AGN luminosity is affecting this result that our liners are lying on the main sequence of star formation, what we did was we took the entire sample of Sloan data, so basically the same ones that were studied in this work, and then for all the liners that in Leslie were detected at low redshift, for the same sample of liners, we've seen what is the percentage that is located on the main sequence depending on the AGN luminosity. And the AGN luminosity was measured in the same way as we measured for our data. So we've seen that as we are increasing the bean of AGN luminosity from 43 to 45, the number, the fraction of liners that are lying on the main sequence is increasing as well. So from 2 for the first bean, from 2% to 37% in the case of the last bean of the AGN luminosity. So we can say that basically the fraction of star forming galaxies that we have at least for the low redshift liners, and at least up to 0.3 as we can see for the high redshift liners, is actually the dependent on the AGN luminosity. We did it also for the safer two galaxies, and basically these sources here in many aspects are more similar to safer two galaxies. However, the emission line ratios are those corresponding to the liners. So the summary and then the main conclusions. So just to remind that in all previous works, the local liners were characterized as being massive galaxies, mainly hosted by early types, and then with low extinctions, having small amounts of dust and gas, with old and intermediate stellar populations, and then with unimportant star formations. For the most luminous liners in the local universe that we studied in this work, we've seen that we basically have all morphologies that we are dealing with higher extinctions in the case of these sources, and with much higher star formation rates. These kind of liners that I just mentioned were first detected, as I mentioned, at redshift 0.3, so they were not observed previously they were there in the local universe, but just since the population is so small, they were not studied. And with this work, so we confirmed the existence of the same type of sources that we have at 0.3 in the local universe, with the same finding the same properties in terms of star formation luminosities and AGN luminosities and stellar masses as well. We've seen that they lie along the star formation AGN luminosity line, suggesting the coevolution between these two properties. We've also seen that most of them lie on the main sequence of the star forming galaxies. And finally, we've seen that the fraction of the liners that is lying on the main sequence is actually related with the AGN luminosity. So that's, am I fine with the time? Yes. Okay. I don't know if we have time, but I wanted to, so Pepa mentioned that I'm moving soon to Entoto Observatory and Research Center in Ethiopia. So this is, and I just wanted to mention a few things about the center. So this is completely a new center. They started about 2 years ago. They started a few years ago with the construction of the observatory. So there are two observatories that you can see here, each of them with 1 meter telescope. And they have one high resolution spectrograph, and then CCDs, the standard set of filters. And then they constructed the research center together with the observatories, and put together the four sciences, so astronomy, astrophysics, then the space science, the geodesy, and satellite technologies. So the center is just starting now. And here you can see, this is just the building in front of the observatory. So you can see Addis, the capital, is below. Here you can see people just working in the fields with very traditional agriculture. They really want to make the center like internationally recognized. Now they're very motivated in building the first satellite that will be the first satellite for agriculture, for monitoring the water reserves, the fires, and so on, the first of that kind in all East African region. And this center is the first center of such kind, not only in Ethiopia, but in all, again, East Africa, and then Central African region as well. So the program that they have now is to give the opportunity to the professors at the public universities to get their PhD, because the number of professors that have a PhD is only around 10% in all kinds of science. So now professors have possibility to conserve their positions at the university, and then during 4 years to get their PhD, and then to start with the small research groups at their own university. So this is the idea. And as I said, the center is just starting now, so they really lack people, and they need a lot of collaborations. So if also we will need a lot of support in the terms of PhD supervisions for the master students and the PhD students, the professors, no, who are doing now their master and PhD. So I just want to use the opportunity that if in the future, if you are interested in collaborating and helping with a master or PhD supervisions, then yeah, you can contact me, and that would be really a great help. Okay, so that's all.
Enrique?
Well, thank you and congratulations for your presentation.
Thank you, Enrique.
Have you, with the young galaxy cluster, how do you assign membership?
Okay, so that was done in the previous works, and they did quite, so it was based on the photometric, mainly on the photometric redshift. So there was a sample, the small sample using, so from the previous works, there were data, Deimos data, and the spectroscopic redshifts for a shorter sample, and then they measured the photometric redshifts. But then in order to confirm, there are about 300 members of the cluster, and around 60 galaxies have been excluded, so they are still potential members, but because the redshifts are not reliable. And then in order to confirm the redshift, so they did all the analysis with modeling the noise, and then doing the Monte Carlo simulations in order to confirm that the galaxies are members of the cluster.
To go back to the previous slide.
To the previous?
Yeah, no, that one, because just to make sure the last
Yes, so in this case, the last one, this is for all aligners from the Sloan sample. So all those detected with BPTs, basically, with DR7, so all of them were studied here.
Yeah, can you go up two slides?
This one?
This one?
The previous one? Previous, okay.
The
first with the histogram, with the mass.
Yes. Yeah, this is a very interesting one. We realized before, but the top right diagram, you find that the most luminous lines occur at masses about 5 to 10 solar masses. Now, this is a pivotal stellar mass in galaxy evolution where you can optimize the effects of the star formation. More massive galaxy more effect. Have more star formation, but then when you increase the mass from about 5 to the 10, the AGN feedback kicks in and that reduces star formation efficiency.
Yeah.
So it is interesting that the more luminous lines actually are distributed around this
that curve, yes.
Mass where the efficiency of star formation effects are maximum, as opposed to the luminous lines, which are more massive, they should be ideally have more star formation, but they are probably the feedback from the AGN decreases star formation.
Decreased,
so
yes.
This is a very interesting result. And it's confirming one of the
Actually, we in one of the first versions we touched that topic as well, that we are maybe just on the limit, you know, between the on the transition, you know, but since we didn't really get into the more detailed analysis, so at the end we excluded it from the paper, from the submitted version. But yeah, you're right.
Any more questions or comments? Yes, I have a comment. So what is next in this line of research?
What is next?
Yes.
You know, Peppa. So the next that we are planning to do is with these kinds of liners to study the torus properties. So we found the WISE data in mid-infrared for the entire sample of most luminous liners. And then for also the entire sample of the luminous liners, so those that are, as Enrique said, so those from here. So we are planning to do the analysis of the torus for both types of liners, and then also to compare the properties of the torus of these liners from with the properties of the torus from other sample of liners. The normal liners that and the X-ray detected liners that Peppa and Isabel are working with Omaira, and then to get more information about the torus properties. Yes, Emilio.
Getting different star formation rain from, you know, from optical and infrared observation. You know, the first data, the difference is very big. Right?
Let me go to that.
Before scout.
Here. Yes.
Now you have something like
yes.
More than almost 100%. But when you say after correction, what does it mean?
Okay, yes, so I mean, as I said, with the optical data we only mapped the central regions of the liners, no? So, and in the case of the far infrared, either with Herschel or with IRIS, we are basically mapping the entire galaxy. So what we are getting, the difference that we are getting there between 3 and 13 is expected, you know? So, in order to get the some kind of clue, what would be in optical, the star formation rate if we take the entire galaxy, But as I said, taking deformation from the nuclear, we scaled with the scaling, we assumed that the specific star formation rate is staying constant. And then just from the star formation rate that we got in the nuclear region, and then having the total stellar mass from Sloan of the total stellar mass, we got what would be the star formation rate for the entire galaxy, but as I said, assuming that the specific star formation rate is constant, which we know from the beginning that it is not the best assumption, but it is the only thing that we could do.
Okay. So it's a geometrical correction.
Sorry?
It's a geometrical correction. You are already dividing yourself to the volume where the optical data is placed.
Mass.
And the other question is how the absorption, how the extinction is already could be already affected in this kind of estimation from optical and from infrared. For example, you suppose that you have to correct from revenue in this region. All right, so the extinction law is more or less the same for every ADN of all this kind of radio. You can consider this a good hypothesis of starting to work.
The extinction law that we used.
Yeah.
Yes. So in I mentioned that for these galaxies we used the Cardelli extinction law, but we also compared it with Calzetti. So we ran starlight with exactly the same parameters that we showed here, but using Calzetti law, and we obtained differences lower than 20% in terms of the final fits. So we compared the extinction, the AB parameter that we get at the end, we compared the mass that we are measuring, we compared the stellar populations, and in all, and then the goodness of the fit, and for all four parameters, the highest differences were around 20%.
Mm-hmm. More questions? So, let's say.
Thank you.